morning, everyone. I'm really glad to be here. I was actually here virtually just a few weeks ago, but it's nice to be here in person this time for the symposium, and it's clear this is an amazing community that's doing amazing work, and so it's really my honor to share some of what we're doing down in Maryland here. We just heard a lot about nutrient treatment. One of the stories I'm going to try to tell you today is rather than just treating nutrients, we actually need to recover them so that we can reuse them. So let me see if I can get this working here. Okay, so first I want to thank my group. We have a really hardworking, positive group of students and postdocs on our team. And I specifically want to mention one person here. Does anyone know who it is? So Dr. Hui Chen, So Dr. Hui Chen here is a Stony Brook graduate. She did her PhD here with Professor Shao and then came down to UMBC for her PhD, or for her postdoc, sorry, where she's been doing an amazing job, and she'll be starting her assistant professor position in the fall at James Madison University. So thanks for sending us some of your best and brightest down to UMBC and our team. We really enjoyed having her on our team. All right. So our research program, for those of you that saw my presentation a couple weeks ago online, our research program looks like this. We have two big areas. Okay, the first one that I talked about a few weeks ago is really everything about contaminants of emerging concern. We deal with pharmaceuticals, personal care products, PFAS, just like your center, okay, thinking about them in the natural environment as well as engineered drinking water and wastewater treatment systems. Today, I'm going to be talking about the second area, which really focuses on resource recovery. Okay, and in particular, I'm going to focus on nutrients like nitrogen and phosphorus, a little bit of a heavier focus on the phosphorus from my perspective here today, and we're going to focus on both municipal and agricultural waste. Okay, so nutrient pollution is a big deal. We just saw that, you know, the map of Long Island, very nice map, you know, showing the hypoxic zones and some of the fish kills. Okay, but this is a big issue around the world. So I want to ask you a question. It's a very vague question. What are we looking at here? Does anyone know what's interesting about this photo? You can just shout it out if you want. Okay, I'll give you a clue. It's this white line. Sorry. Let's see here. It's this white line that's kind of cutting up on this diagonal. Oh, this is tricky. I'm doing my best here. But you see that white line? Does anyone know what that is? You can see a photo from the ground here. I heard someone saying it. Okay, this is the world's longest conveyor belt. Okay, it takes phosphate rock that's mined down here at the bottom of this figure out to the port. Okay, it's over 60 miles long. This is in Western Sahara, just below kind of the boundary with Morocco. It's the world's largest phosphate mine. And it contains something like 70-75% of the world's phosphate reserves. Okay, this is really important. We don't have phosphate everywhere. Phosphate is mostly in one place. This is a huge liability as we move forward because we need phosphate to grow food. Okay, so why do we care about nutrients? Well, first of all, we need to eat. Okay, the world's population is growing exponentially, which means we need to produce more food. We need fertilizers to do that. Okay. Second, peak phosphorus will be occurring not in the next century. The estimates vary, from anywhere in the 2030s, out. Okay, and so at that point, it's going to start getting more and more expensive to mine phosphorus because the reserves are being depleted so fast. So we need alternative sources. This is why I say we don't just need nutrient treatment, we also need nutrient recovery. Okay, around the world, over 1% of the world's energy goes to producing ammonia. Okay. We think about nutrient treatment and wastewater. We turn ammonia into N2 gas. Okay, that's great. Then we take N2 gas out of the atmosphere and we turn it back into ammonia for fertilizer. That takes a ton of energy. Okay, 1% of the world's energy is not a small amount. And so if we could save some of that by recovering the ammonia from waste instead, that would offset, a lot of concerns about climate change. And then finally, as we've already heard, water pollution is a big deal for nutrients. Okay, so I think this crowd already knows something about, hypoxic zones, eutrophication, dead zones forming, but I'll just give a quick primer here just to kind of remind you that it involves both nutrient discharge from wastewater treatment plants or septic systems and also agriculture, so whether that's animal ag or crop ag. As those nutrients get into a water body, they can spur a lot of algal growth, and then as those algae die, they consume the dissolved oxygen in the water, which fish and other organisms need to survive. Okay, so this has impacts on, you know, fish populations, biodiversity, but also tourism, ecotourism, recreation, and even water quality for drinking purposes. So just two examples here. I saw this one in the news just like a week or two ago. This is a lake in California. I thought it was a little bit interesting because it's called Clear Lake, but it's very obviously not clear. Okay, you can see it's very green here. And then a very famous case in Lake Erie from about a decade ago now, algal bloom in Lake Erie produced a number of cyanotoxins at high concentrations. And so the city of Toledo had to shut down their drinking water for 2 or 3 days. Okay, what do we do without drinking water for 2 or 3 days? This is a very tough situation, you know, and something that we don't really expect to see in the U.S. Okay, this is also happening around the world. This is just a map showing you hypoxic zones or dead zones that form all around the world here. You can see the East Coast and Gulf Coast of the U.S. very heavy, okay, because of our wastewater systems, because of our agriculture systems, especially in the Gulf of Mexico. Okay, but again, this is a global issue, and I hope you can see with the little plot on the bottom here that the number of hypoxic zones is increasing exponentially decade to decade. Okay, so we need to do something about this. But why is it happening? Why is this increasing, you know, compared to the past? Well, it's because we're taking nutrients like phosphorus and nitrogen from where they've typically lived, you know, on our planet, and putting them into aquatic systems. Okay, and so we talk about these geochemical flows or biogeochemical flows of different elements around the planet. Okay, in the past, phosphate has been these phosphate reserves in Morocco, but now, because of, you know, wastewater effluent, because of agriculture, we're sending it into the aquatic environment where it wasn't before. Okay, so we're shifting where phosphorus has been around the planet, the same for nitrogen. Some of you may be familiar with this concept of the planetary boundaries. So there's 9 planetary boundaries that have been identified by a group in Stockholm. And the idea is that once we exceed those boundaries, it's going to be very hard to get the Earth back in balance. Okay, it's going to cause kind of long-term lasting impacts. Nutrients, so these biogeochemical flows here of nitrogen and phosphorus, this was one of the first planetary boundaries that we exceeded. Okay, we're well past those boundaries at this point. This is going to be a problem for us as we move forward. Here's what our phosphate consumption looks like if we continue business as usual. Okay, it's going up because the world's population is going up. We do have some opportunities to kind of cut back on our consumption of raw phosphate rock. Okay, so this is a dark green here. So right now you can see we're increasing that consumption. We're going to hit peak phosphorus. This is going to have to go down. How can we get the phosphate that we need to grow the food that people want to eat? Okay, well, we can do some of this by just introducing some efficiencies in agriculture, changing diets. This is going to be hard to do. Okay, it's hard to change practices. However, we can also make up some of this difference by recovering nutrients from both human waste and animal waste. Okay, and this is really what I want to talk about with you here today. So as Dr. Gobler mentioned, you know, I'm not in New York, so I'm going to tell you the Maryland story here, and particularly the Chesapeake Bay story. I think it's really interesting, and there may be some parallels you know, that we see between our respective locations. So here's the Chesapeake Bay. It runs up through the center of the map here. Okay, and it's very interesting to me because on the western side, we have a lot of urban areas, a lot of people, a lot of large wastewater treatment plants. And on the eastern side, the blue dots here, these are all poultry operations. And so we have kind of the wastewater side and we have the agriculture side, and they meet in the bay. Okay, so whether it's contaminants of emerging concern or nutrients, this is kind of a very interesting testbed for us. every year in the Chesapeake Bay, we have a big dead zone that forms. So you can see this is the one from 2021. Okay, and it's because of the nutrients that are coming through the wastewater system and from this agriculture. But if instead of discharging those nutrients, we can recover them, okay, turn them into high-quality fertilizers and send them somewhere else, hopefully we can take this dead zone and fix it that we don't have this issue. Okay, we can improve biodiversity, we can improve our fish populations, our fisheries, and all the economics that come with that. Okay, we do a lot of work, you know, with wastewater treatment. Today, I really want to focus on the solids. In many ways, it's more difficult to treat the solids. It's a much messier matrix. There's a lot of other stuff in there. And so this is one of the reasons why we're focusing in on it. You can see here in the US, we produce over 7 million tons of dry solids from human waste every year, and over 300 million tons from animals. Okay, these are very big problems. I'm going to try to tell you quickly two stories here today. Okay, and the first is on animal manure. So here's a map that we put together of the phosphorus loading per area of farmland in each state. Okay, I don't need you to look at the details here. All I want to really emphasize is that Maryland, Delaware, and North Carolina are the deepest blue, which means that we apply more phosphorus per area of arable land in those states compared to anywhere else in the US. And in Maryland and Delaware, it's because of the poultry industry. Okay, here's a map of the Chesapeake Bay watershed. It covers six states, including a little bit of New York up here. Okay, and this map in particular is showing the darker the red color, the phosphorus that's delivered from those sub watersheds into the Chesapeake Bay. Okay, and so there's a lot that's kind of just outside of Philly right here. And then this peninsula, we call it the Delmarva Peninsula, it contains some of Delaware, Maryland, and Virginia, is very dark red, again, because of the poultry industry. Okay, actually, on that peninsula every year, we produce over 600 million birds. Okay. That's two birds for every person in the country. Okay, so two chickens for you, two chickens for you, everyone else in the country. Okay, they're all produced here. Okay, and so a lot of very intensive industry just in this very small area of land. That means a lot of poultry litter, chicken poop, okay, that gets produced. Over 1 million tons of chicken poop, which is very rich and very concentrated in nutrients, both nitrogen and phosphorus. Because the soils on the eastern or on the Delmarva Peninsula here are so saturated with nutrients from the decades of the poultry industry's operations, there's really no capacity for the soil to hold more. And so any new applications runs off into the bay. Because of that, Maryland instituted some new rules about, close to a decade ago now, that limit about 20% of farmers from land applying their waste. So they actually have to truck their chicken manure out somewhere else. Okay, because of the soil capacity. Now, I think this is really important because in the past, agriculture and environment have kind of butted heads with each other. You know, we're kind of arch enemies in a little bit of ways. And I think when we think about nutrient pollution, it tends to kind of lead to finger pointing. Okay, but that doesn't help address the situation. When we think about nutrient recovery, now this is a resource that farmers like our partner Lee Richardson here, I don't know, are there any other Lees in the audience? There's not a lot of Lees, so whenever I find a Lee, I have to work with them. So Lee Richardson, he's one of our partners. He has this great quote here, you know, they don't want to just send their waste away. They know it's important. It's good for soil amendment. It's good fertilizer. They want to kind of hold on to those resources for themselves. And so in working towards recovery, we can actually talk with each other, which is critical. So we went out to Lee's farm, we went out to a lot of other farms with our Home Depot buckets and came back with lots and lots of chicken poop, back to the lab, started measuring the chemistry. Here's just an example for a couple of background ions. I want to point out two things. First, we have a lot of ammonia, phosphate, and potassium. These are the three main nutrients that we need to grow crops, okay, present in the poultry litter. And second, across these four farms here, so the different colors are just different farms, the contents are pretty similar across the board. Okay, so poultry litter doesn't vary in composition so much compared to what we might see in municipal wastewater. So we took all this chemistry, we plugged it into a chemical equilibrium modeling software, Visual MinTech, to understand what phosphate species exist at different pH levels. Okay, if you're not a chemist, don't worry. The only important thing here is that if we bring the pH down, we can release all of the phosphate. And if we bump the pH up, we can precipitate phosphate here as three main species, either struvite, magnesium ammonium phosphate, potassium struvite, magnesium potassium phosphate, or hydroxyapatite, which is the same mineral as your teeth and your bones. Okay, we, in particular, want to recover struvite and potassium struvite. So that brings me to our PAIRS system, phosphorus extraction recovery system, that we developed specifically to address this issue for farmers in the Chesapeake Bay. The idea here is that you take your poultry litter, Sorry, working this out. You take your poultry litter, you throw it into some water, mix it up, generate a slurry. And then the idea for us was that we can actually take advantage of waste CO2, so also try to address climate change issues to acidify that slurry. Okay, as we acidify it, we release the nutrients from the solids. So those nutrients are now in the liquid phase, and the solids have low nutrient content. Okay, so we extract them off. They're a great soil amendment. Farmers like Lee Richardson can use that on their fields and improve their soil quality. The nutrient-rich liquid moves forward in the process. We aerate it, knock that CO2 back out, add a little bit of base. That allows us to precipitate our struvite down here. And then we take the wastewater effluent and we recycle it for the next batch of slurry production. Okay, so I'm just going to walk you through a couple of the steps here. This is the initial acidification step. So we generate our slurry and we're somewhere around pH 7 down here. As we add acid in, or CO2, we start releasing the phosphate. And we hit a bit of a plateau around pH 4 to 5. We could extract more, but then we have to add more acid. That adds costs. It's not going to be feasible for farmers. Okay, it's not, you know, going to be a real-world technology. And so we kind of focus in on this pH 4 to 5 set point. On the backside, after we remove the low-nutrient solids and move the high-nutrient liquid forward in the process, as I mentioned, we aerate, and so we're able to precipitate some of that phosphate out, and then we add some base to bring the pH up to around 9. That's kind of the optimal pH to precipitate struvite. Okay, and I hope you can see here in the orange bars, we're getting very good extraction of phosphate from the poultry litter, and the green bar up here, as we increase the slurry strength, we're able to get very good precipitation efficiency for the phosphate. Okay. On this slide, we're moving forward from just the high nutrient liquid. Okay, so we've already extracted it and removed the remaining solids. And so we're starting down here around pH 4 to 5. And we start bringing the pH up. We're precipitating, you know, our products. Okay, I've told you before that we're precipitating struvite. But actually, in the baseline process here, we also precipitate some calcium phosphates, which again, we don't want. Okay, they're not good fertilizers. The phosphate is very strongly bound, and so it's not good from a reuse perspective. So we get some calcium phosphate, some struvite, but we really wanted to focus in on improving the purity of the struvite product. So we added some chelating agent, EDTA. We can add other ligands as well to interact with the calcium and prevent that from precipitating. I hope you can see down here from these SEM images, we see a much kind of more consistent product. Okay, either struvite, we can bump our pH up a little bit and precipitate potassium struvite. The only issue here is now we're getting lower precipitation efficiency, and so we're not recovering all the phosphorus that we could. So we just add a little bit of magnesium on top, and now we're able to get very good recovery efficiencies and a very pure struvite potassium struvite product. One thing that's important about these is they're slow-release fertilizers. So unlike conventional fertilizers, which dissolve pretty much right away, these dissolve slowly, so you don't see nutrients run right off into your water body, but the nutrients actually get to the plant instead. Okay, so these are better fertilizers, first of all, and we're taking advantage of our waste stream. So that was all kind of done at the bench scale in beakers. Okay, we took this, we leveled it up a little bit to a sequencing batch reactor in the lab with a 45-minute cycle. Okay, and so here in the blue curve, you can just see the pH profile through this 45-minute cycle. So we're generating our slurry, we're doing the acidification, removing the phosphorus from the solids, putting it in the liquid. We're separating out our low-nutrient solids, and then we're raising the pH to precipitate our struvite. Here's how the phosphate levels behave through the system. You know, and again, we get very good extraction and precipitation efficiencies. In this case, over 70% phosphorus recovery. Some of our partners said, if you can get over 50%, that's pretty good. So we felt great about 70%. Because of this, we leveled up again, and we built a pilot system in the lab. I think these reactors are all 30 or 40 liters. Okay, we put this together. And I really want to give a shout out here to our former PhD student, Utsav Shashvat. He really focused in on the process chemistry that I've been showing you. And one of our former undergrad students, Charlie Portner, he actually put this whole reactor together as an undergrad, like, super impressed, plumbed everything, put all the controls in, and it's completely automated. It's so cool. You put the poultry litter in the top up here into reactor 1, you press a button on the computer, and everything does what it needs to do. You get your low-nutrient solids at the bottom, and you get your high-purity struvite fertilizer from the other bucket. And so he did a really awesome job. With this pilot system, we actually got even better performance than we did with our sequencing batch reactor. We got over 80% phosphate recovery from the poultry litter. This was really great. Right now, we're working with a couple of people in industry that are looking to license this and start commercializing it and getting it out in farms. Okay, the 80% is kind of going to definitely meet their profit margin, you know, for putting this into work in the real world. You might look at this and say, okay, you're not getting a lot of nitrogen or potassium, though. And this is true. It's because those nutrients are present at much higher concentrations in the poultry litter. And so if we wanted to recover those, we could add additional phosphate in. But that wasn't kind of in line with our, you know, goal of just treating the phosphorus in the poultry litter in the first place. So there's potential to take this further, and definitely depending on the chemistry of your waste. Okay, so after we precipitate our struvite, now we have this waste water, you know, that's still kind of rich in organics and inorganics. Like I said before, we recycle that around to make up the next batch of slurry to recover more nutrients, you know, from our poultry litter. We went through 10 cycles here. We were able to meet that 80% recovery, total recovery of phosphate across those 10 cycles. And so this was really great because we're not producing an excess volume of waste water in recovering our nutrients from the poultry litter. And this is important because there'd otherwise be on-site wastewater issues for these farmers. Finally, I'll just wrap this part up by telling you that we know that there's a lot of other contaminants of concern in animal manure, especially antibiotics like enrofloxacin here and hormones like estradiol. In this case, we spiked these in to our poultry litter. They weren't in the samples that we had obtained at levels that we found in the literature, you know, for other animal wastes. And we wanted to make sure that we weren't enriching and concentrating antibiotics or hormones in our recovered fertilizer product, because otherwise we might be causing another issue downstream of our system. And so here's our, you know, waste products. We have the low nutrient solids, we have the recovered struvite, and then the process effluent. And I hope you can see that there's very little antibiotic and hormone in the recovered fertilizers. There's very little antibiotics and hormones in the process effluent. They basically stay in the low nutrient solids. Okay, so we're not treating them in this case, but we're also not raising an additional concern because our fertilizer isn't loaded with antibiotics, and when we put it on a field, it's going to cause other issues. And so we felt pretty good about this, and I think there's opportunities to couple it up to other systems to actually treat these contaminants as well. So I want to quickly share with you one other story. We like our acronyms in our lab. So that was PAERS, this is NERDS, Nutrient Extraction and Recovery Devices. And these technologies take advantage of a process called Donnan dialysis. Okay, Donnan dialysis is a kind of specialized chemical phenomenon that happens across semipermeable membranes like ion exchange membranes. So here I have an anion exchange membrane. It's separating a feed solution that contains phosphate and a draw solution that contains sodium chloride, okay, just table salt. Initially, there's an electrochemical potential gradient for the phosphate from the feed solution to the draw solution and for chloride from the draw solution to the feed solution. Okay, that causes them to want to migrate and equilibrate that electrochemical potential across the two solutions. So as we move towards equilibrium here on the right-hand side, okay, what I hope you can see is that we started with 10 phosphates over here, and at the end, at equilibrium, we have 8 in our draw solution. Okay, if I wanted to recover 9 of those, all I gotta do is increase the sodium chloride concentration in the draw solution. Okay, it's all driven by the salt content. And so we have a lot of control over this process. We know how to design it, you know, for equilibrium recovery of phosphate and other nutrients. We also understand all the mass transport. I'm not gonna get into all of those details here today, but I just want to show you a couple of applications of how we put this in for nutrient recovery. So starting from some model solutions, solutions that only contain phosphate or ammonium. Okay, here we're just kind of going with a flat sheet reactor. It looks just like the schematics on the previous slide. So I have an ion exchange membrane in the middle separating the waste solution and the draw. In the case of phosphate treatment, you know, we're starting up here. Phosphate concentrations in the waste are going down, and in the draw solution are going up. Same for ammonium. Okay, we got about 90% removal in this case, which is what we designed around, and about 80% recovery because some of those nutrients remain in the membrane for this batch. system. We felt pretty good about that, okay, but you can never use a system like this in real practice. And so we wanted to innovate a little bit and think about how can we actually get this technology into the real world. And so here I want to again give a shout out to your alum, Dr. Hui Chen. She's been very important in advancing our work in this regard around these tube-in-tube reactors. Okay, these are modular systems, and they really focus on this inside tube, which is the ion exchange membrane. Okay, so it's one tube inside of another. In the outer tube, we'll have like our waste solution, and the inner tube, we'll have our draw solution, and the exchange happens just like I told you before. Okay, so in these modular systems, we'll recover on the top here cations. So we'll exchange the sodium from the draw solution to recover ammonium and potassium. And the bottom here, we have anion exchange tubular membranes to recover phosphate by exchanging chloride. Okay, so we're recovering our nutrients in this case into separate draw solutions. We mix them together, and just like before with pairs, we're producing struvite on the back end. Okay, we put this to work for a synthetic urine. We wanted to think about nutrient recovery from synthetic urine. Here's how it looks in this case. We're getting pretty rapid and pretty quick removal of phosphate, ammonium, potassium from this urine. In this case, the treatment time, I think we were using two modules here. Like I said, it's a modular design, so we can level up to 4, 6, 8, you know, whatever it is, that will change the recovery time. But we thought that this would be really good for low volume waste. Maybe we have 3 cycles of nutrient recovery per day to recover nutrients from urine. Okay, one thing that's also really cool about this system is if we control the volume of the waste and draw solution. In this case, the draw solution is lower volume than the waste. And so we can actually concentrate nutrients to higher levels in our recovery solution. That improves our ability to precipitate them on the back end as our struvite fertilizers. Again, you can see from the SEM image down here. And with this, we were about able to get over 85% recovery of both ammonia and phosphate from synthetic urine. Okay, but like I said, some of the solid waste pose other concerns, okay? And so I wanna tell you just in the last few slides here about some of our work recovering phosphorus from coagulant-laden waste-activated sludge. And so if you're a wastewater treatment plant, you're trying to meet very low phosphate levels in your effluent, you may add some ferric or alum on the back end to co-precipitate the phosphate out, okay? Those solids end up getting mixed in with the waste-activated sludge, and so you have this kind of organic-rich, you know, solid waste, but then there's also these metals in there that very tightly bind your phosphate. And so you could think about digesting those solids, releasing the phosphate, but now you're releasing all kinds of other stuff with them, and it's going to be very difficult to recover high-purity, high-quality fertilizers like struvite from that. What we wanted to do in this case is add some ligands like citrate here to complex the aluminum in the solids and release the phosphate, and then recover the phosphate across an anion exchange membrane via Danon dialysis. Okay, so let me start just with the synthetic sludge. This is a sludge that was just made up of aluminum hydroxide and then co-precipitated phosphate on it. So the phosphate starts bounds to the white solids here. Okay, on this slide, I'm just showing you how we can release the phosphate from those solids and put it into the water phase. Okay, we looked at 4 ligands in this case. In the blue over here is citrate, and this red is EDTA, and the green is oxalate, and then the yellow is acetate. And what I hope you can see is that as we increase the ligand dose, we start dissolving some of the aluminum, and then at some point, we release all of the phosphate. Okay, we see that for citrate, EDTA, it takes more ligands when we're using oxalate here. Acetate wasn't effective, and so that kind of drops out of our picture. So we know that we can release the phosphate. Can we actually recover it via Danon dialysis? So again, we came back, you know, to our little bench scale reactors. So we have our waste solution. This is the synthetic alum slurry. Okay, we have a membrane between that and our sodium chloride draw solution here. Now the plot on the right-hand side is a little bit complex. The first panel of figures here, this is the phosphate concentrations in the waste solution. Okay, so all of these symbols bump up from 0, which means that we're effectively releasing the phosphate from the solids. Okay, that's good news for us, but that's just one part of the story. Okay. The center panel here is the phosphate levels in the draw solution. So we can release it from the sludge, but can we actually get it across the membrane into the draw solution where we can then, you know, recover it in a much cleaner way as these fertilizer products that we want? Okay, if we look at this, we can see here for citrate, we were able to effectively recover the phosphate. For EDTA, we were able to effectively recover the phosphate, but for oxalate, we weren't able to. Okay, even though we released it into the waste solution, it didn't cross the membrane. At the end of the day, for this proof of concept figure, we were able to get like 50%, 60% recovery of phosphate with citrate and EDTA. but we can take advantage of some of the same engineering techniques from before to bump that up. Okay, this is just proof of concept here. But we wanted to understand why the different ligands didn't show the same phosphate recovery via Donnan dialysis. So again, we went back into our chemical equilibrium modeling tools with Visual MinTech, and in this case, we were looking at the aluminum chemistry in the presence of the ligands. Okay, what's really important here is when we add citrate, aluminum citrate complex has a zero charge. This is the dominant species. The EDTA complex has a negative charge, and the oxalate species has a 3- charge to it. Okay, that charge is really important because it poses, when it's negative, competition with phosphate to bind to the membrane and move across the membrane. And actually, the higher the charge, like it is for oxalate here, the more competition that gets posed, and so that means our phosphate recovery is going to go down. Okay, and so this is actually really cool. Like, this has a lot of applications for other systems. If you have two metals with very similar chemistries and you want to separate them, okay, we can do that with some kind of complexation-enabled Donnan dialysis system, just like we're doing here for phosphate. So next, we took this to a real waste. Okay, we went out to some treatment plants in Maryland that do this phosphate polishing, and so they had very high aluminum content in their waste-activated sludge. We were able to model the phosphate release from these systems very nicely. We did that kind of comprehensively, considering all of the, you know, inorganic chemistry, and then only considering the aluminum chemistry. And actually, if we know the aluminum content, we can get a pretty good estimate of phosphate release from this sludge. Okay, you can see this is pretty strong stuff that we're working with here. Okay. If we digest that, maybe we'll get something that looks like this. And again, the point is, it's going to be very hard to generate the high quality fertilizers that we want from this digested material. But when we apply it to the Donnan dialysis system, now we're able to recover our phosphate over into this solution. You can see maybe we get a little bit of background organic matter as well, but this is very clean and we can generate our high purity fertilizers. Again, when we apply this to the real waste, 50 to 60% recovery, but I think there's a lot of room there to improve that through some engineering and optimization steps. So I think I'm probably at about time. I'll just conclude very quickly, you know, to say that rather than just doing nutrient treatment, we really need to think about nutrient recovery for a lot of reasons. As I told you, phosphate reserves are geospatially skewed. If Morocco wakes up tomorrow and say phosphorus costs 1,000 times what it cost yesterday, you know, that's going to be a big liability for the world's economic security, political security, lots of issues involved there. You know, we know that nutrients are key to food security, water security, and so as we move towards a circular nutrient economy, we can address some of these very complex interwoven issues. I'll thank our funding sources, and then I'll thank you for all of your attention, and I'll be looking forward to your questions during the panel. Thanks so much.